Hello, my name is Peter Gong. I'm a First Nations artist that lives here in Mission, BC. And I was actually born in Mission and raised up on the Wanak Reserve in Maple Ridge. And it's just a little 10-acre plot of land that right on the Fraser River with Wanak Creek flowing in behind it. When the government was handing out reserve land, that particular plot of land was designated for the Cheer family, and I'm a direct descendant of the Cheer family. So we grew up knowing that even though it was reserved land, it was designated for the Cheer family, and we felt like we were just coming home. My grandmother, Clara Cheer, was born in Kilgard, which is just over here in Sumas Mountain. And when she got older, she married a Squamish man, and my mother was born in North Vancouver on the reserve there, and that's why I am Squamish Nation. And so I spent most of my life working, either cutting shake blocks in the bush with a chainsaw, working in mills in one shape or form, packing shakes, driving forklifts. I ended my career as a head shipper in a lumber mill, and I spent almost 30 years in one place. And that was in 2009 when the mill shut down. That left me at 54 with something to do. I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I knew this. I didn't want to work in the mills anymore. And I wanted a total change in my life. So I went back and finished two or three courses that I needed for my grade 12. And I did that here in Mission at Riverside College. And I started looking at university courses at the University of Fraser Valley. And I was designated to take some courses in 2011. And I wanted to work in the school system with Indigenous youth. And I was hoping I could provide a positive profile for First Nations youth. I ended up volunteering on a couple projects with my nephew, who's also a Squamish Nation artist. And I'd started in 2008, the fall of 2008 with him. I had two or three knives that my uncle had given me. And I started whittling on this Mission house pole with him. And by the time the project ended, it was just him and I working on it. And it went to Japan. And then in 2009, he got a contract to create two welcome figures for BC Hydro's main office in Vancouver. And I also volunteered in that. And from that time on, I started acquiring tools, knives, adzes, and stuff like that. When you want to learn how to do Indigenous art, you have to hook up with mentors. And a lot of this leads into a traditional way of passing on knowledge. So I hooked up with the Coast Salish artist, George Penye. He's a well-known Coast Salish artist. He was from Chilliwack. He lived in Chilliwack. He lived in Mission. He just lived wherever he wanted. And that's one of the things about First Nations art. It's very portable. You can take a few tools with you. You can continue to create art wherever you're at. And then I hooked up with a Neutronoff artist, Tom Patterson, here in Mission. He'd married a still old lady, and he lived here in Mission with her. And I have to credit Tom Patterson with pushing my skill set, giving me a sense of quality and to my pieces, to not pull up short on them, to try and create the detail that just to keep striving to keep getting better at it and creating nice detail that can separate your pieces of art from other people's pieces of art. When you work with Northwest Coast Formline, it's very important to keep studying it and figure out how things work. And I feel I have so much more to learn. I mean, I do work within Formline, and in a lot of ways, I feel like I'm just beginning to understand how that works. And like I said, it takes a lifetime. I mean, it's one thing to draw it and paint it. It's another thing to carve it. And so that's kind of where I'm going with it now. I'd like to carve Formline designs on bentwood boxes. I make bentwood boxes here in my shop. And I sell them to other artists, and I put art on them myself. So when I started studying art, First Nations art, because I had an overwhelming passion to learn, I started collecting as many books as I could get my hold of my hands on about West Coast Native art. I think the best way to learn is to hook up with mentors, First Nations mentors. My friend Tom, my friend George, who's passed away now, they both studied with Tony Hunt Sr. at Arts at a Raven. And Tom would leave school every day, and he would go carve for half a day at Arts at a Raven. It was a program that he was in. And it ran for 2 years. He told me that when it was done, he just didn't leave. He just stayed there. And there were a lot of elders or older carvers that would work at Tony Hunt Sr. and create art. So you had the advantage of learning from multiple mentors at the time. And a lot of different styles of Northwest Coast formline art, carving and painting and designing. And so he was a fountain of information for me. But you take on a certain responsibility when you start creating art pieces that are cultural pieces, to portray them in a good way and to pass on the proper knowledge behind it. And a good example of that is I got a sun mask up there with the four carpenters. And I just went up to Bella Coola in December with Skills Ready, which is a part of Construction Foundation of BC. And they promote Indigenous skills within the community. And I went there to teach bamboo box making. And while I was there, I had a good visit with Alvin Mack, one of their foremost carvers and one of their elders up there. And I talked to a lot of the younger Bella Coola artists. And it was told to me that this mask actually is a sun mask representing the four carpenters. So I was very happy to learn that, because now I can tell the proper story behind it. And so it means a lot. It's very important to go out into the communities and learn the story behind a lot of the art that's created, the creation stories. Every nation has their own creation story. So I'm hired by these liaisons to create art pieces. And a lot of it is, they want involvement with the students. So one of the things I've come up with is I'll design up panels that I build here in my shop. And then I'll go into the schools, and usually it's a volunteer thing with the middle school and high school kids. And they'll do it on their own lunchtime. I'll design it, and I'll get them started painting on it. And with the liaisons, they'll come in behind me and they'll finish painting, and they get to a certain amount of involvement and working with the designs like that. I do what they call directed drawing with the lower grades. I'll go in the classrooms and I'll get hired to teach basic form line or basic drawing skills with Indigenous art. And also go in and demonstrate carving skills. I'll go in with some basic tools, some edges and a block of wood, and demonstrate how these tools are used. I've been in the high school here in Mission and had high school students come up to me and say, "I remember you from Dewey Elementary when you came in." And so there's some satisfaction in that, you know, because they say it in a good way. I think the youth now, with the education, with the mandatory Indigenous cultural thing that they're dictated to teach now in the schools, it's going to help a lot. And for someone like me going in, now they have exposure to it, First Nations person, in a positive way. I think Indigenous way is a very strong tool to give the rest of the society exposure to First Nations culture. And it doesn't matter what kind of First Nations culture that is. It could be Inuit, it could be Métis, it could be Plains, or it could be back east First Nations. That's what Indigenous Day is. It's a tool so the rest of the society can get a glimpse into life or the culture of First Nations people and see it in a positive way.